Hello, and welcome to Weed and Grub.
December 18th.
Yeah.
At the San Pedro Taco Bell.
Okay.
Alana Beshiome.
Okay.
I'm not sure how to pronounce her last name, so we'll go with Beshiome. She has now filed a lawsuit with the Los Angeles Superior Court.
Okay. So this was last December 18th, I'm imagining.
Yes.
Okay.
But it has finally reached the Los Angeles Superior Court because at her San Pedro Taco Bell,
okay,
she is suing them for a raunchy alcohol-fueled Taco Bell party that included open sex.
Oh. In the Taco Bell?
In the Taco Bell during the holiday party. But it gets so much deeper than that. Like, that's the clickbait headline.
Mm-hmm.
But for everyone who saw this on Twitter or already knows it, if you have not read the article, there is a lot to unpack, and I wanted to start with it.
Okay. So many questions. I'm just going to let you get through it, and
okay,
then maybe I'll ask you things.
So I'll get to the scintillating stuff from the headline first, but then also, I think there is more egregious things that Taco Bell should sue her for.
Oh, I'm so excited.
Yeah.
This is a great, okay.
Okay.
Great.
So to start with, here's her lawsuit at the San Pedro Taco Bell. Her supervisor covered all the windows and the cameras in the lobby with wrapping paper.
Okay, wait, I have just up top.
Yeah.
Was this a Taco Bell holiday party?
Yes.
Okay.
For all employees.
Gotcha.
And their significant others.
It wasn't like an office party that came to the Taco Bell. It was actually, gotcha. Because like, fuck yes. Listen. You know,
yeah,
like I've been to so many holiday parties when I was a restaurant worker and they would have a holiday party at like some other restaurant. Take us to a Taco Bell.
Yeah.
Please.
Yes.
Lay on the Crunchwrap Supremes.
Well, in this case, this is an employee and significant other SO party.
Okay. Got it.
So they covered the windows and the cameras in wrapping paper.
Jesus.
Already then,
like.
They overserved, the supervisor overserved alcohol to the entire staff.
Mm-hmm.
And then around midnight, she stepped out for a short time, and when she walked back in, she saw a coworker having sex with his wife in front of everyone.
Oh my God.
The coworker was also kissing her female manager and another female coworker at the same time. So an orgy broke out in the lobby of a Taco Bell.
That's not even open sex. Yeah, that's straight up like, wow. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Group sex happening.
Yes. Also, she saw an employee throwing up in a trash can.
Yeah.
Right.
That's and then, every night at a Taco Bell.
And then another, and then her manager and another coworker were having a sexual encounter near the vomit.
Oh.
Like, what a crazy party. It was only midnight.
I did not expect that. That caught me totally off guard. Sorry. I was like, sexual encounter near the vomit.
Yeah.
No. Okay.
Okay. And so then she reported the incident to Taco Bell Human Resources and the Alvarado Restaurant Group, who owns the stuff. And the manager and all the coworkers were all fired. And then after their termination, the person doing the suing says she was threatened and had her car window shattered by someone associated with her former coworkers.
Okay.
And she also claims that Taco Bell did nothing about these threats and instead told her that they were just going to transfer her to a new location rather than discipline the employees.
Mm.
And now she is saying she has suffered actual and consequential incidental financial loss. And there is a lawsuit happening. So I will stop there.
Okay.
With those are all her claims.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
What up, Mary Jane?
How's it going, Mike?
So good. Welcome to a very fun Weed and Grub, everyone. This is a podcast about comedy,
cannabis,
culture,
cooking,
calling shit out,
and group sex at holiday parties.
Many parties coming up. Wear protection.
I'm not going, but yeah, have a great time, everyone.
Well,
yep,
I'm
be
coming
safe.
Or going.
Yep. Awesome. Female condoms, everyone. Evidently, they work great.
Somebody was just doing stand-up about that the other night at the Comedy Store.
They're back in the zeitgeist.
Huh.
Yeah.
And they were saying how great they felt and how they really recommend them as well.
Yeah, they're very, very safe. And the cool thing is that the woman, so it's like you put it into your vagina and then it's just kind of ready for whenever you're, like you don't have to have, the guy doesn't have to be erect to actually put a condom on in order to have sex. So you can just sort of like be ready with the protection in place and then have sex whenever you're both ready and you're both protected. It's just on the sort of opposite end of the condom spectrum.
That is right? Such a good move for a holiday party.
Don't you think?
Yeah.
Just be ready.
Be ready. There's no wrapper in the trash can.
Yep.
There's no like...
Just show up with your female condom in place.
Yes.
And then you can go. Just don't do it next to the vomit. Guys, please. That's just... No.
So here's the what I consider more egregious part that Taco Bell should sue her for.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Taco Bell suggested and encouraged all people to bring food for the potluck style buffet. Mm. Her contribution was a bowl of guacamole.
Uh-huh.
You don't bring guacamole to a Taco Bell party? That's crazy. Why would you bring Mexican food to a Mexican fast food restaurant? And it's a holiday party at a Taco Bell. You think that they don't have all the fixins that you sit around next to every day?
I'm confused because you were making it sound like the party was already catered by Taco Bell and then when people were also invited to bring their own dishes, or was it just a potluck?
It says nothing about the own dishes, but it is a potluck.
Yeah.
But that's like if you worked at McDonald's every single day and then you were like, oh, let's have the holiday party here. And you were like, oh, I guess I'll bring meat patties.
Great.
Like, no, it's not. You work with that food all the time. You should be bringing something outside of your work culture zeitgeist. If you're going to do a potluck at a Mexican restaurant, you don't bring tacos. That's what you work with every day. You bring something else.
I mean, I think it's arguable that Taco Bell is a Mexican restaurant. And also, I think guacamole is a very good choice because I love guacamole. So I would be happy. And I think you should bring the thing that everyone loves. Don't you think?
No, because you're around it all the time. I think everyone was like, this is disgusting. We eat this all the time.
So
what are you doing?
Like, what, supposed to bring like something from the
fried
you grew
chicken,
up with?
Macaroni and cheese.
Okay. Fair enough.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Yeah. Root beer floats.
Great.
Not guacamole.
Okay.
Then.
Fair enough. I feel like this is kind of a cream corner up top, too.
I know. Well, we
got to get to some plugs before we dive into our cream corner.
Okay. So she stepped outside, mm-hmm. walked back in, sees an orgy.
What was she doing outside?
Probably smoking a cigarette.
Okay.
Right? That's my guess.
These are just, as the lawyers, fair to know, what were you doing outside?
Yeah. My guess is smoking a cigarette or something.
Okay. Fair enough.
Shocked and disgusted, she said she ran out of the restaurant after seeing the sex. And then she ran back into the restaurant because she forgot her guacamole bowl.
That's the best part of this story.
I know, isn't it? It's the part the least amount of people are talking about, and everyone should be talking about
that. That's it. I mean, she lost her case.
Right there.
She lost her case.
I was shocked and appalled.
Shocked and disgusted, but I had to go back in to get my guacamole bowl. Holy. I don't even know where to go from that. That's perfect.
Isn't that funny?
That's a perfect story.
Like, she ran out, stutter-stepped, hit her knee, goes, dang it.
I'm just going to have to watch my coworkers having group sex while I retrieve my Pyrex.
Yeah, her hand is covering her eyes. She's feeling for the buffet table to retrieve. Do you want that guacamole bowl?
No.
No.
No. If I'm surprised by my coworkers having group sex at an open holiday party, I don't need to retrieve that bowl. Also, I could just get it another day. And also, why are you being such a narc with your... Like, I understand that it was problematic. You didn't feel safe. It was upsetting. Like, I get all of that. But really, to report it to the HR... Like, I don't know how I feel about that. I don't know. I would have to think about it a little bit.
I don't like it at all because it's around midnight. Everyone's partying.
Yeah.
Had you decided that this wasn't for you from jump, then you should have left from jump. You don't go in, do all the things, leave, come back, see things, leave, come back.
Yeah. I don't know.
Come
I don't
on.
Know. I've been at some holiday parties. There was one holiday party when I was working at a place in New York. I was a bartender and the holiday party got really fucking out of control. And a couple of people did lose their jobs and it was because they hooked up in really terrible ways. And it was bad. So I understand there being repercussions for doing things like this, but for her to like sue and take it to HR and all, like that should have been dealt by, wait, was it the management who were the ones who like put the wrapping over the...
Correct. The supervisor.
So I guess that's why she went to HR. I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it. I would not personally report, but also I guess you got to do what makes you feel safe.
Well, but you sound like someone who would have brought guacamole to a Mexican restaurant Christmas party.
100%.
So you're as culpable in
my
eyes
as she is. My guacamole recipe is fucking delicious and everyone would thank me for bringing it.
Okay, what do you got? You add a little lime?
You got a little minced red onion. You got a little minced tomato. You got a whole lot of cilantro. You got obviously a shit ton of lime and or lemon. Obviously the fresh guacamole. And then minced jalapeno. Mm. No cumin. I disagree with our friend Caitlin Gill on that because she put cumin in. Cumin? She put it in her guacamole. And we went back and forth about it. And was like, yeah, it's a different flavor profile.
What's your spice level for guac specifically?
Hot as fuck.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Agreed. You got the cooling cream.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. A whole lot of jalapeno going on.
I would also say my personal preference for what to use as the dip vehicle.
Is it your dick?
Is my dick.
At a holiday party?
At a Taco Bell holiday party.
Great.
Yeah, I'm trying to, you know, I can't believe they omitted me from this lawsuit. But, you know. No, an everything bagel pretzel chip.
What?
I love that combination.
God, you blew my mind. Never heard of such a thing.
Okay. Red package, they're nice.
Like a Stacy's?
No, that's a pita chip. I'm talking about those thin little pretzel chips. They're shaped like pretzels.
Yes, I do know. Yep.
Yeah.
Totally know
I think
what you
that's
mean.
The best dipper.
Weird. Okay.
Okay. So anyway, I just wanted to bring that up
top. Fantastic.
Because everyone is partying. Everyone is around family. People are losing their mind. If any of you have a great holiday party story, please send it to us.
Oh, boy. I mean, yeah. I stopped going to them after that one in particular that I mentioned because it was really upsetting. Like, people did really get out of control. A couple people lost their jobs. Nobody felt good about it. Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to wake up.
Coworkers, yeah. Right?
It's yep. Like, ugh, no exactly. Thanks. You don't want to wake up the next day and be like, did I touch her back too long?
Yeah.
Shit.
Oh, God, I've got the cringes because I hit on that person who definitely didn't want to be hit on, but I just like had that courage. Mm-hmm. And now I have to work with them.
Okay, can I tell you something over here? If that ever enters your brain as a thing to say to someone else,
what?
Do not say it to them. Hey, can I tell you something over here?
Oh, yeah.
I saw a lot of that at the Second City Chicago holiday parties.
Can I tell you something over here? Like over where?
Like in the corner or in the other room or somewhere that we can...
Outside in the alley behind the dumpster.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Got it.
Yeah.
Well, we have some plugs before we get to the rest of our show.
Oh, okay.
Can you swipe that, please?
Yeah.
We are at the MJ's this week. When this episode comes out, we will be in Las Vegas prepping at the Pearl Theater at the iconic Palms Hotel and Casino for the MJ's, the International Cannabis Awards. I don't even know if you can still get tickets. Can you?
Probably not. But hopefully we're able to film some of this and we can throw some of our hosting
skills
online. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. I don't want to say. Yeah. Thank you.
Mad skills.
Yeah, we're going to crush it at a theater.
Yeah. It's just really exciting. And there have been some cool articles coming out. Honeysuckle Magazine just posted a really cool article as an interview with the founders of Fairchild who are throwing the MJs, Dave and James. And I think it's going to be really neat. So come hang out with us in Vegas. If you're at MJ BizCon, look us up. We're going to be at the parties, at the after parties, at the four parties, at the mid parties, you know, maybe having group sex at the Spirit
Vegas,
Rhino.
Vegas is the only place where they zoom the cameras in instead of cover them up.
Yeah.
So let's go for it.
Let's go for it. It's going to be a good time. What else we got?
How was your Thanksgiving?
Oh my God. How was your Thanksgiving?
Well, do I want to talk about, can we talk about mine in a bit? It was just like so big and it was my dad's whole side of the family. Mm-hmm. And I feel like we've already dumped a lot on our listeners with that Taco Bell thing. So if I come in too hot, too quick with all my stuff, I worry that this episode will take a weird turn. So let's talk food for a bit longer.
A real creams corner. Cause that last bit wasn't a cream corner so much as a vomit corner. This is, I am proud of the day after Thanksgiving dish that I made. So I went to Hawaii and I stayed with some friends and our friend Natalie and her little baby Ruby came and it was a real family Thanksgiving. It was so lovely. And we had all the fixings for the big turkey dinner. And then the following day, we were like, what do we do?
Did you cook the dinner? Cook it?
We all cooked together. I didn't do much. I kind of stood around and
telling people what to do and saying salt that more, do this. Yeah. Did you want to wash that dish before you use it?
Some frowning, some foot tapping. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just
some
a real
stern
leader.
No, I did dishes. I did dishes and tried to, I can't even remember. Yeah, I guess I melted some butter at one point.
Whoa.
Yeah. You know, key. They don't have a microwave. So I had to do it on the stove. Big, heavy lift.
Holy cow. Did you put the burner on high? What happened?
Just low heat, small pan.
Unreal.
Melted it right down. Happened so quick. Amazing. Who knew?
Huh.
The following day, we had all of these leftovers because they had an 18-pound bird, which was so exciting. So there was plenty of leftovers and all of the veggies and everything. And I was like, I'm going to make a turkey pot pie. And everyone looked like, what?
Yeah.
Like they hadn't even thought of that. And I used to do this on the boat. It was kind of like an easy meal that's sort of also like comfort food and it feels kind of impressive. And I just wanted to kind of share that on here, that I've like resurrected my turkey pot pie or chicken pot pie dinner. We've got a little video of it if you're watching our YouTube. I don't know why you're hovering your finger over it like that.
Because I wanted you to say to YouTube first before we got to it. God, look at it. It looks delicious.
Thank you.
What a great utilization of all leftover ingredients.
Yes. Thank you. It's really, and so the key for this particular dish is that I don't use a pie crust. So it's not really a pot pie, but I make a biscuit topping instead. So there's no pie crust underneath. It's just made in a big casserole dish with the roux and the cream sauce and the veggies and the meat. And then you top it with a, like kind of a drop biscuit. And then you put it in the oven, that kind of bakes up. So it's a little bit like chicken dumplings.
Yeah, which is one of the most comforting things in the world.
It was so good. And it came out really, really good. And it was delicious and full of butter and cream and turkey. And I used a lot of tarragon, which is, I'm kind of in love with tarragon right now.
Yeah, yeah.
That fennel-y, lovely kind of, you know, threads everything together really nicely. And so that's, yeah, that was my cream corner.
Did you use like the cream of mushroom, green bean, that cream to bind all this? Or no. Did you make everything kind of from scratch?
Yeah, I made it from, so I sauteed, minced an onion and sauteed it in 2/3 of a cup of butter. And then I added 2 tablespoons worth of flour and made a roux with chicken stock and milk. And then once that had thickened, I threw all the veggies in, which I'd blanched, and then leftover turkey, and then bubbled that up and then made the biscuits and dropped that in and baked it in the oven.
Oh, so you heat everything together before the oven part, because that's really just to cook the biscuit.
Yep, exactly.
Nice. What a cool technique.
The glop was hot before the oven part. And I put it in at 400, Mike.
Yes, you did.
For you.
Hey, I'm getting yelled at left and right for shit this week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Harding texts?
I keep getting texts from people that are like,
well, because you said I saw that on your Instagram story that you were like, what did you say?
I'll tell you the story.
Okay.
That sounds delicious. I don't want to wax over
your
thing.
It's fine. Go ahead.
It's delicious.
It was great.
But motherfucker, man, it's just common courtesy. If you're texting with somebody for an extended period of time, all information has been given, you have connected on all the things, I send a heart, we're done. There's no more, oh, maybe this, maybe that. And that mostly goes for my parents and a couple of my friends. You know who you are. Mark, you're looking at me. It might be you as well. And it's just, here's an example. Mm-hmm. Hey, Mike, can you do this show at this time? Yes. Is it paid? Yes, it is paid. Can you send me your credits and your photo? Yeah, we'll send in my calendar. Thanks so much. You're welcome. I heart it. Mm-hmm. Next dot. How's your Thanksgiving going? No, 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 no. We've done the thing. We are not moving on to topic 2, topic 3, and having a long text conversation now that there will be no escape from, because that's such an open-ended question. Mm-hmm. It'll go on forever. Mm-hmm. I hearted it. That's case closed, baby. Put the phone down. Move on.
That's a unilateral case closed, though.
What does that mean?
Like, maybe you need to send something back that they can also heart. And then it's a double heart. And it's like you said, it's like, you know, you can't just be one person saying goodbye when you leave a party. The other person also has to say goodbye to have that sort of closed circuit of like, we've done the thing. So maybe they're feeling the need to like, you know what I mean?
Okay. So then when I heart that and then they write back, how's your Thanksgiving going?
You tell them to go fuck themselves.
I tell them to go fuck. And then they heart that. Okay. Okay. No. I think you're right. No. Then my move would be going so good. Hope yours is going great too. And then they heart. Do you know what I'm saying? I got to shut it down.
It's a lot.
It's too much. So I had to put that PSA out. If I heart.
Yeah.
We're done.
Well, then you hearted something that I sent you when I was in Hawaii. And I was like, oh, okay. I guess we're not talking anymore. And then you were like, no, I didn't mean it. And I was like, well, I don't know. I saw it on Instagram. So
you're not alone in that kind of come for me text thing happening in my life right now. What do you do when somebody like has doubled down and then they're like, hey, let's keep moving on to different topics?
I don't know who your friends are. I don't have people who over text me. I feel like maybe it's because I'm in my 40s and everyone like my age has kids. And so there's just no fucking time to do anything more than be like, can you have dinner at my place Friday, December 17th at 8 p.m.? Mm-hmm. And I say yes. And then they heart that. And I'm like, and we're done.
I love it.
It might be, that's part of it, is like a lot of my friends are just raising small children.
Yeah.
And they have no time.
My favorite people to text with are male comedians in their early to mid 30s.
Oh.
Because it's
my least favorite.
Like, let me read you. This is from Matt Lockwood.
Okay.
I love this man.
Okay.
He should come on the pod sometime.
Maybe he's a butt of the week.
He sent me the text, tomorrow, 3 p.m., my podcast, ? I wrote back, give me an hour. And then he hit me with the thumbs up. Hour and a half later, I wrote, tried to make it, but I can't. And he thumbed down that. Today I texted him and wrote, what about next Tuesday? And he said, figuring out our schedule. And then I hearted that.
Great.
Keeping it clean.
Yeah.
Efficient. Simple. Informative.
Great. No emotions.
Nothing.
Just men talking.
Just men fucking talking.
Just men texting. Men texting. I watched that movie, Women Talking, on the plane on the way to Hawaii. It's absolutely beautiful. And all I could think the whole time was like, every bro in all of my comment, that is the movie that would literally make their heads explode with rage, because it truly is seven women in a barn sitting on hay bales.
And does the movie last forever? Oh, it's only 2 hours? Yeah. Oh, I thought it'd be three times as long if it's all women talking.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm not giving you that at all. I was presenting a topic that we could like gently have made fun of together.
Yeah.
And then you just like,
I came in too
hard.
You
didn't do it.
I'm sorry.
You didn't do the thing.
You're right. I dropped the ball on a yes for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can we go
Moving
backwards?
On.
No, we got to go a little backwards, please.
Okay.
Okay. Set me up again. Look, give me another try.
I watched that movie Women Talking on the plane to Hawaii, and I thought that this is the movie that would send all of the bros in my mentions on my sandwich videos completely for fucking, they would send them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
Nice try, Mike.
Damn it.
Great. I appreciate the attempt so much. You will never know how much that means to me that you just tried. Great.
A third try. Okay.
No.
Let me just say one extra, like, new one last try. Third time's a charm.
Mm-hmm. I watched that movie Women Talking. Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it.
Right. It's really great. It's a bunch of women talking.
What would I like about it?
All right. What else?
No, what should I have said? What's a good thing to say?
I don't know. I truly don't know. Yeah. I think I was just trying to, I don't even know. When we listen back to this, we'll be able to retrace it and maybe dissect it and be like, okay, what could we have done there? Because it just kind of went off the rails because he was like, I don't know what to say. I don't know. Maybe I should just be quiet. Maybe I should just sit here and be quiet. I will say, holy shit, the Thanksgiving that I spent with the Hansons, who are the family who welcomed us into their home, and then Natalie and baby Ruby, there were seven women and one guy, Charlie, the patriarch of the family, Charlie, the dad, and then there's Lucy and their daughters, Harper and Lark, and then Lucy's sister, Chelsea, Natalie's baby Ruby, and me, and Charlie was pretty quiet. At one point I looked over and he was just on his back, lying under a drawer, fixing it.
Hell yeah.
Yep.
Hell yeah.
And he took the dogs for a lot of walks. I was like, I feel that. Yeah. I feel it. He's the best. And then we did actually have one awesome drive. We were driving somewhere and I was asking him about all of his time in Alaska, because we actually met through the Alaskan fisherman scene and he worked on boats for a really long time. And he was telling me just absolutely crazy stories of like crab fishing and stuff. And it was really great.
That's so nice.
Yeah.
But yeah, man.
Yeah. Guys. Yeah. What do you do?
Go to my shed and tinker.
You're doing your best, man. All guys are doing their best. I just, you know, I appreciate you so much for like trying to engage with me on that and often engaging with me on that stuff.
Yeah.
We did pretty well.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I mean, it's a work in progress.
Mm-hmm.
There's always a better answer. It's not a right answer, but there's always a better answer.
Yeah.
Than why or silence.
Or what would I like about it?
Or what would I like? Or just a flippant joke that focuses back on me.
Oh, Jesus.
You know.
Wrap up cream corner real quick. I wanted to say that I also made potato croquettes and they worked out great, except the second batch totally fucking fell apart. First batch was delicious. And then the second batch was just fried mashed potatoes, which not bad.
Yeah.
It was just a bowl of fried mashed potatoes.
What, like day old mashed potatoes, bind them with some egg and some breadcrumbs or
something?
Exactly.
Yeah. And delicious. A little Parmesan cheese and then chilled them for a little bit. And then I took them out and I fried the first batch. But by the time I'd fried the first batch, the second batch had warmed up enough that it just kind of went like,
Yeah. Like a cast iron with some oil, something like that?
Yeah.
Delicious.
Thanks for asking questions, Mike.
Hey, you know, women love to talk.
Men love to say shit too. Here we are talking, a man and a woman with a podcast.
Yeah. Are we progressive?
I think so.
Okay.
We do pretty well.
That's nice.
I think we suit each other's vibe.
That's important.
It is.
Yeah. I love that too. The day of, you just melted some butter, did some dishes, but day two, you kind of took control and made the most out of what I consider to be one of the best parts about Thanksgiving, the day after food.
The leftover stuff?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, also, I mean, I was truly a guest in the Hansons' home, so like there wasn't much I could, I didn't want to muscle my way in and be like, I'm taking over Thanksgiving dinner here. But to show up and cook a nice meal on the second day felt really good.
That sounds awesome. Yeah. What was your dessert situation?
Oh, pies, pies, pies. We had pumpkin pie. We had blueberry pie. Harper made a fucking phenomenal apple crisp. We had, yeah, just like a lot of like creams and sauces and dips and slurps and ice creams. It was great.
Oh, nice.
I weighed myself when I got back and I was like, oh, damn it.
Really?
Yeah, because I was trying to be, because the MJ is because we're on stage this week and I was trying to be a little conscientious, but my step count went down and my calorie count went up. So I was, I did okay.
Okay.
I did okay. It wasn't terrible.
I do know a great, at least according to my TikTok, a great, very fast weight loss move. Not normal.
Amputation?
Like, yeah. One is like, you know, amputation, of course.
Right.
But the carnivore diet, apparently.
Oh, God. What is that?
Because you stop retaining water. It's just meat, butter, eggs, oil, salt. And you just eat nothing but like steak and eggs and you drop so much weight so quickly.
So I should start doing that today for the show this Thursday?
Uh-huh. If you eat nothing but steak and eggs, you will lose all your, it's all water weight, of course. Okay. But apparently that's what happens when you start the carnivore diet is you drop all your water weight.
Oh my God. Is that what that guy, the liver king, is that who I've seen on TikTok?
Yeah.
That's what he
espouses,
right? But
he has abs implants. You know, he has like implants in his abs.
Ugh.
Isn't that wild?
Yeah. And I think he sells like steroids or something, doesn't he? Isn't he like on all sorts of stuff?
He's on, he claimed at first that he was on nothing. Mm. And then everyone was like, you're on something. And then somehow his med records got released and he's on everything.
Yeah.
And also his diet pills and protein packs and whatever the fuck he shills. It's all like FDA unregulated nonsense. Like he's a snake oil salesman with fake abs, silicone abs.
Yeah. And when your muscles have veins like that, and then the veins have veins.
Look at this bitch.
Yeah. Oh my God. He's so crazy. Oh, there's one of the thumbnails that producer Mar just pulled up is him with just the big word liar next to us. Okay. Got it.
Yeah.
What about your Thanksgiving, Mike? What was your jam with your family?
Yeah. My fam jam was fantastic.
Nice.
It's the first time in ever that my entire dad's side of the family all came together, the Glazer side. And so I met all my cousins, kind of reconnected with them for the first time ever, because I haven't seen any of them since I was, I don't even know, at least 20 years.
No.
And now some of them have kids. All of them have kids. Cool kids too. Kids that are champions and rad to hang with. And hung out with my uncles and aunts and my brother and Patrick and dad. It was great.
Yeah,
it was
so great. So nice.
Had a really wonderful time. Shout out to Don for having all of us in his home in Boston. Shout out to my cousins, Molly and Elizabeth, for making it all happen, pulling it all together, starting the email chains, booking the restaurant for the day after. Like, they made it happen. So I'm really thankful for that. The food was completely catered because there were so many of us and one cook in the kitchen would be 20 cooks in the kitchen and everyone has different dietary needs because some of them are in their 70s and they can't have salt and other people are lactose intolerant and some people love this and that. And they were like, we're catering it, take it or leave it, or bring your own Pringles. Shut the fuck up. Let's hang. It was great.
Yeah.
And the moves that I loved the most that I wanted to highlight, tarragon in the sweet potatoes.
Love tarragon.
It's crazy.
I'm about it.
Yeah.
Yep. Was it fresh or dried?
I think it was fresh and folded in.
Okay.
You know, chopped up real fine so it was fragrant and then folded into the sweet potatoes.
Love it.
Yeah. Really, really nice.
It's such a nice complex little layer, right?
It really is. Mm-hmm. The gravy was great. The key lime pie was pretty good.
Ooh.
We had some fancy Boston ice cream that was creamy and cold and delicious.
Okay.
And
was it Van Leeuwen?
No, but similar.
Okay.
Very similar. Mm-hmm. Great mashed potatoes, great green bean casserole, and amazing mac and cheese. And I'm usually very suspicious of mac and cheese. Mm-hmm. I find that most mac and cheese with the baked breadcrumbs on top, I find it's like weirdly bland.
Sure.
Like it's either super oversalted because all the cheeses are too crazy, or all these cheeses just kind of mud together and it tastes bland.
Mm.
But this was really good.
Did you feel like it had my favorite mac and cheese are done with a bechamel?
Maybe that's the key because it was extra creamy and not very stringy.
Wet and gushy.
Wet and gush. Yeah. The low light for me was the actual turkey.
Oh.
And I didn't see many people eating it around the table. It was great for sandwiches the next day.
Okay.
But overall, it was a smoked turkey from this place. And it was freaking gross. I have a picture of smoked meat to talk about smoked turkey. I don't think you should smoke a turkey.
Okay.
I think it's like, it's a weirdly dry, kind of under satisfying bird. And we all know that. And everybody talks about how it's not that good, but we eat them on Thanksgiving. Smoking it, it doesn't hold the smoke well. It tastes only like smoke. There's no like depth of flavor like in the dark meat the way that there is in chicken or duck or anything else that has that really smoky, unctuous profile for a gamey bird.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a little too flat and therefore a little too overpowering. And it's just not that great.
That's an interesting thing to think about, is that it's like really the fat that holds on to that smokiness. Because I smoked fish when I worked on the boat, and it worked so well with salmon.
Yeah.
You know, obviously smoked salmon is... You know, it's a thing, right? Smoked salmon.
Wow.
It's like really popular.
As a Jew, I am offended.
Let me ask you some questions as a Jew about smoked salmon.
Explain lox.
I think lox actually is not smoked. Isn't lox just cured? I think that's the difference.
I just lost the bump in my nose. It has been revoked.
Let me explain lox to you, Mike. Oh, fuck.
The Israel-Palestine conflict is slowly but surely, Mary Jane is explaining to both sides. Oh, wait, here we go.
What?
The main difference. Smoked salmon is cured and then smoked, whereas lox is only cured.
Yeah.
There goes my bump.
Both are fucking delicious. But when I was smoking salmon, we had a little smoker on the back deck and you could put some alder. Generally, that was the way that we used. And then you'd smoke it in this little smoker. And it was a whole process and it was fucking delicious and wonderful, but also time consuming. And like, you kind of had to know what you were doing to like really get it to taste right. Or you could just buy liquid smoke, which I didn't know about, which is just a bottle of fucking chemicals that does really give it that smoky taste. But I wonder
but
if you're
gross.
Yeah, it's terrible. It's just, I don't even know what's in there. It's just, yeah, it's liquid chemical smoke. And I wonder what you were, I'm sure this turkey dinner was probably very nice. And so it wasn't liquid smoke that you were eating.
I don't know, but it was overpowering and it was underwhelming.
Hmm.
I do have one unsung hero that I'm in love with that I wanted to bring up to you.
Yes.
Under the dessert area.
Okay.
Have you ever heard of grape nut pie?
Say
I should have
more.
Pulled up a picture of it. I'll show you this.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so here's the ingredients. I just looked this up because I didn't know, but I ate, I think, a slice every day that I was there. It was so good.
Was it like milk bar good?
Like no, not at all. Good? More of a custard.
Oh.
So it's grape nut cereal, water, eggs, sugar, dark corn syrup, salt, vanilla, butter, and you do grape nuts in warm water to get them soft. And then you combine and beat the eggs. And you fold in the grape nuts to the eggs and you spoon it into a pie shell and then you mix it with all the sugar. And it's just this like custardy, almost savory because of the grape nuts. So it's not overly sweet, eggy, sugary, molasses-y, vanilla-y pie that is like perfectly unsweet. I think that'd be the best way to describe it.
Yeah.
Perfectly unsweet.
God, that sounds good. I grew up with grape nuts in the house as a breakfast cereal that my dad had shredded wheat every day and my mom had grape nuts every day. And it was just like, I never enjoyed them, but I can imagine how good it would be with custard.
Yeah.
And they have that nice little satisfying crunch and they're also kind of good for you, I think, because they've got fiber.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was delicious.
How's your digestion treating you after Thanksgiving?
I mean, we are all Jewish and there was only two bathrooms. So there was like, you know, a lot of maneuvering. A lot of like, how long are you going to be in there? A lot of questions of like, I can wait.
Yeah.
I'll just break out in a cold sweat while I wait. Don't worry about it.
What can I say? So at the Hanson's place, Natalie and I were sharing this kind of little guest spot that was like a big, kind of like a studio with a bedroom and bathroom. And there was a little mini fridge in there and I'm obsessed with Korean radishes, takuan.
T-A-K-U-A-N.
I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce it. Takuan. But I became obsessed with them at Wee Spa after like doing a soak and a plunge and then going and getting a bowl of ramen. They serve them with these gorgeous little radishes and they are so crunchy and delicious and fragrant. And when you crack them open, it smells like farts. And I had them in the mini fridge in our little room. And Natalie, she was just like, every time I cracked them, she was like, what is that? And I tried to blame it on Ruby's diaper, but no, it was It was my farty radishes. But I swear to God, they're so freaking delicious. I can't get enough. I am kind of glad I live on my own. I am going to stock up on them because this is my new smell. My new jam.
We're in Vegas at the MJ's and you're like, did somebody bring a pocket of radishes over here? Oh my God.
I'm so about it. I was just dropping Archie off at Kate and John's house, which is where I just made it smell like that crazy steak dinner right before I left. And I was thinking, like, I'm one of these people who is just, I cannot wear beige and be low key.
No.
I am big smells, big moves. I'm steak dinners and fart radishes. That's my like, if you were to paint someone in a palette of smells,
yeah,
that's what I smell like, is a steak dinner with fart radishes. It's not bad. It's a lot.
I need to go on one of those AI programs and type this in to see what the photo looks like.
If anyone's looking to date someone, smells like steak dinners and fart radishes. It's great. It's hot.
Do you think of yourself? Are you an inconsiderate smeller?
I'm coming to learn that I am.
I think so.
I'm beginning to learn that I am because of that steak dinner absolute insanity, which I'm still feeling guilty over. Obviously, I'm bringing up 3 weeks later. No, I try not to be. I truly do. I try not to
be. We got a bunch of DMs though from people who are like, hey, maybe the scent air will work. Oh, wait, just listened more. Okay, you do talk about the scent air fixing the steak dinner.
Yeah, shout out our wonderful sponsor, scent air. They have done wonders for my home. And I definitely, like, when I'm cooking, I'm remembering to open windows. I'm airing things out. I'm using the scent air. I'm trying to be better. But I have realized, like, I love onion sandwiches. I don't know what it is about me. I really like weird, pungent stuff.
I like the neutral flavor of a grape nut pie.
Yeah. And I love fart radishes. Delicious.
Unbelievable. Oh,
was that a good spot to get to our news?
Yeah, let's get to the news. Oh, we have to do that ad.
Yeah, no, it's not an ad. Here's a spot from our friends over at Lasagna Ganja.
Welcome to the Lasagna Ganja podcast. It's the podcast that combines cannabis education and entertainment. And believe me, it's layers to all of this. I'm X to the Z exhibit.
I'm Tammy, the cannabis cutie. And join us as we explore the world of cannabis from its history and culture to the latest industry trends and scientific breakthroughs.
So whether you're a seasoned smoker or new to the world of cannabis,
join us on the Lasagna Ganja podcast.
New episodes drop every week. So hit subscribe and come along for the high. Let's go, baby.
We're back.
This is the news, the Grubly Gazette?
Yes.
I'm going to read the news this week.
Okay, fantastic. I love this story.
Hold on.
Brought to you by Santerre.
Let me find it.
Because this story also has to do with smells.
There it is. Yeah. This is crazy.
Yeah.
I'm such a fan of... Hold on. Reset. Great. Okay. This is from NBC5, which I learned is no longer called mainstream media. But people are calling it traditional media.
Oh, I thought you were going to say lamestream media and I was going to punch you.
No, but I did have a huge conversation with my my aunt and my aunt's sister and my dad and my brother and Patrick.
Who else was there, Mike? What time was it and what was everyone wearing?
About the news.
I've really rubbed off on you.
It's very funny. I like it.
Set the scene.
So my Aunt Palm's sister sat down and goes, hey, do you think we could turn on the news? I'm really wanting to know what's going on with the hostages. And everyone said, no, it's Thanksgiving. We're not doing that. We're not turning on the TV. We're not crowding around the news. It's still going to be there tomorrow, but tonight's about family.
Keep the temperature low.
But we did start talking about the news, and the consensus was, because everyone's in their like 70s and 80s, they were like, you know, I really try to watch as many different news channels as I can, but it is on in the background all the time. CNN, ABC, NBC, some Fox News, just to see what they're omitting on each side. And I said, well, what about things like TikTok and Twitter? And they said, oh no, that's where all the fake news is, and that's where the lies are. And I'm so concerned about that, because it seems like all the younger generations are getting their news from these places. And I said, yeah, that's where I get a lot of my news from. That's where I found that Taco Bell article, was on Twitter. And they were like, yeah, we don't do that. And I was like, well, wouldn't you want to get your news from an array of places and also see where these younger generations are getting it from? Because I don't trust NBC, ABC, CNN, Fox News any more than I trust TikTok or anywhere else. Like, I don't trust any of it, but I try and find a middle ground that seems like there are some facts in there.
Well, let me just say, I think you're using Twitter as a news aggregator, and it's not that you're not trusting those news sources, because like the Taco Bell story, for instance, was reported by KTLA.com, which is a traditional news media organization.
You're right.
So you're using Twitter as a news aggregator to find stories from a bunch of different outlets.
Correct.
But you're not just listening to one channel.
Yeah, I don't follow Tucker Carlson or any of those other people on Twitter
you're
to get my news from
them. You're not just
listening
to like Jesse Waters' hottest take about how women aren't fucking people or something. Like that's,
not at all.
Yeah. So it's news aggregation, I think, is more along the lines of, and I think the same with TikTok, right? Like a lot of the news stories that come across my feed, I will learn because I'm following like a Palestinian activist, but then she'll actually link out to like reported news stories. I'm not just sort of like listening to hot takes.
That's such an interesting point, because I not only do I agree with you, but that seems like a more filled out way to get the news than these traditional areas.
Yeah.
Potentially.
I mean, I think it's actually really interesting. So Drudge Report, do you know that website, the Drudge Report?
Yeah, yeah.
Matt Drudge, when I moved to America, had just started out, and he was like a hard-nosed conservative, pretty hard-wing, right-wing.
Nose wing,
hard
cock
ass butt conservative. And I remember the first time that someone showed me the site, and he was like, this is just a great place where I go to get my news. And I was like, this is all super right wing. How can you buy into what he's saying? But it's always been really interesting to go and just see, because he does pull from all of the different news organizations and media sites around the world. And in recent years, he has become more, since the rise of Trump, actually, I think he really saw the problem with what was really happening in far right news media organizations. And so he's become more of a centrist. And now when I go to the Drudge Report, I actually kind of enjoy it, because it's much more in line with what I want to read from, especially with global news, like what he chooses to pull in from Europe and stuff. But I just think like a news aggregator, I mean, even a news aggregator is always going to have some kind of point of view, unless it's like the AP, which is, well, and the AP is news aggregation. Anyway, yada, yada, yada. It's just interesting to, you're saying like, why don't you go for a wider array of stories? You're only listening to these traditional news channels.
Yes. And all of these people who are quite a bit older than me, but it's they care and they want to stay informed, are thinking of these specific maybe four channels.
The trusted news. Like we used to listen to Dan Rather because we believed, you know, Dan was going to be telling us the truth.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that guy who pretended to go to war, but he was never in the war, but he still kept his job. Matt Lauer?
No. And he's what's her name's dad from Get Out. He is the father. His name is Brian Richardson. Mark, help me.
Brian Williams. Is it Brian Williams?
It is Brian Williams. Yeah. Allison Williams.
Yeah.
It's Allison Williams' dad, and I'm sure she doesn't want us to talk about that.
So I just thought this is great. I know we have to get to the Grublic Gazette, which is the number one news source for all things news.
Come to us
for all of your...
We're an aggregator.
We are.
Yeah.
I mean, we come out with some breaking stuff, like this story, for instance. An Essex Junction resident is running a backyard cannabis business with the help of over 30 ducks. Folks, if you're not coming to us for your news,
come on.
What are you doing?
Vermont farmer uses ducks to ferment and fertilize his cannabis grow?
Yeah, that's but a there's a story. Lot of drama.
There is drama.
Yeah, so this is happening in Vermont. Jason Struthers had a dream of becoming a skydiving instructor, but then after sustaining a spinal cord injury, he got a bunch of licenses to grow cannabis in his backyard, up to 100 plants.
Great.
And they are fertilized by over 30 ducks.
Quack.
Quack, quack. It was so funny to watch the video on this and have that field reporter be like, the neighbors are complaining about the quacking.
Yeah. And her name was like Allie Goober.
Yeah.
And it was a great name too.
She's great. Yeah. She needs to smile more as she talks, but she did a pretty
hey
good
now.
Job.
Oh,
come on.
Wow. You just slid that one in there?
Yeah, but that's no. Like, that is, you know that when we read ads on here, we smile because it makes our voices sound happier,
Allie,
as we're reading ads.
Stay as you are. Stay salty. Don't fucking smile because anyone fucking told you to. It's a fun story.
It is a fun story.
So Jason Struthers.
So basically, like, he, all of his licenses say that, especially in his district where he lives, he's allowed to farm. Or he's not allowed to farm.
Not allowed to farm. He's allowed the cannabis grow, but not allowed to have a, like an agricultural farm.
Right. And the neighbors are complaining about the ducks, the noise, the smell, all of those things. And because they are fertilizing the cannabis plants, the neighbors are arguing that he's farming and not growing weed. And so now it has gone all the way up to the Vermont Agency of Agriculture. And there is a huge review coming up in the future about if he is going to, one, be allowed to continue growing weed with ducks, mm-hmm. and two, if he's going to be able to grow weed at all. And as of right now, it's $200 a day fine for him to keep his feathered friends.
Well, I mean, it is a farm. You have 30 ducks. That's legit. Like, you live in a fucking cul-de-sac neighborhood, 30 ducks. That's a farm. I think it's awesome that he hit on this solution during the pandemic. I think he said in the news story that he had initially bought the ducks for meat during the pandemic, and then he got attached to them. And he was like, well, you could just fertilize this weed garden. And it's worked out so well because it's fresh fertilizer. It doesn't need to be amended before he uses it.
Yeah.
These ducks are just straight pooping on his plants and they're growing beautiful weed. And I think it's such a nice symbiotic relationship. But Jason, that is a farm and you need to move.
I don't know.
Yes.
Don't you think that, I mean,
I would want to, I super, super, super would want to live next door to a guy who grew weed using his ducks poop. That is 100% up my alley.
Yeah.
Yes. I love it. I would be friends with him. I would come over. I would get eggs from the ducks. I would bring them. I would make friends with them.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's not what his neighbor signed up for.
I agree. Except I do think to play the devil's advocate, I do think.
Advocate?
Yeah. I thought I'd just say it wrong to have some fun.
Oh, okay. I'm like straight confused. What the fuck are you talking about?
To play devil's advocate.
Abaduck?
Abaduck. That's pretty all right. I do think in a world where the weed industry is incredibly hard to make any profit and finding a loophole like having ducks that provide the type of fertilizer that you don't have to spend money on so you can have better margins and have a better chance and grow better plants. Like, everything about this is great. Just maybe in a different place.
But just move.
Just move.
That's straight farming.
Yeah.
That is the definition of farming. You have 30 ducks and 100 plants.
Yeah.
That is a farm on any video game platform or in the real world. That's your farming, Jason. Good luck.
Good luck. But I love it. I mean, if more people started, what if ducks are the answer?
What if ducks are the answer? I would love to have a farm with ducks and goats all fertilizing my weed plants. And then you're making your honey and the honeybees are using the nectar from your weed plants to make their honey. And it's just all a symbiotic thing. And I live with all my best friends and we all eat communal meals and it's heaven on earth. That's it. I love that.
But not in a cul-de-sac.
But you got to move. Jason. You got to move, buddy.
Yeah. Well, I thought it was a fun news story
this week. It's a great news story. I love it so much. I love Vermont. Vermont's have you been to Vermont?
No.
Oh, it's a wonderful place.
Yeah?
Yep.
I don't know.
Do you like Bernie Sanders?
Not really.
Okay.
Not really.
Anyway.
Like, I was all about him for a minute, but...
I just love that mittens meme.
Yeah, that's, you know, a good mittens
when
meme.
He went to the inauguration and he just sat there with his like mask and his mittens and I was like, yeah, he's
yeah.
Yeah, he's like the real deal.
He is the real
I
deal.
I think there is no lie about Bernie. And
agreed.
That is what I, even though I, there's plenty about him that I think he could have done better, said differently, and that he always hasn't always like treated things in a way where he could have like brought people together, especially young women, like the Bernie bros. It was like a really divisive thing.
Yeah.
And I think he could have reached out to young women a lot more, but maybe he didn't know how to. But
well, he had a live stream with Cardi B that I watched where she ate that mango with her long nails.
Yeah.
She unpeeled the whole thing with a long thumbnail and I was in love.
She was like salting a tomato. So fucking yes. I fucking love her.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. I'm not against him. I just, yeah. Anyway.
Right.
Okay.
So anyway, that's the news story this week. And I had a couple other things I wanted to talk about this week. What else is on our thing?
You got...
is it my turn to read a poem?
Yes.
Okay. So I guess I'll give a little context to this. So we stayed at my Uncle Don's place in Boston. My dad's oldest brother. There's three of them, Don, Neil, and Steve. And, I was telling Don I was going to talk about him on the pod, and he was like, well, you know, I'm so much more than my resume, and I've gotten all these amazing things. And I was like, yes, agreed, but I'm going to still talk about your resume because, one, I think it's admirable, but two, I think it's a really interesting juxtaposition between this poetry book that he just wrote that is doing well, that I'll get to in a second, and his personal career. So he was in corporate law, Harvard Law School. He wrote the book with another writer on corporate law, and there's a new volume of it that comes out every year. He's just an incredible man, and I hope his biotech company takes off. They've created a new cancer drug that is beating out all the other competition, and it has huge promise behind it. So I really hope that helps people all over the world. And he's just a caring, giving man, and he also is a is a really talented artist with a big mind. And so he gave me his new poetry book. It's called Uninvited Guests.
Okay.
Check it out right here.
Love the title.
And every single poem is 17 syllables, super tight.
That's super... 17 syllables is a haiku.
Yes, but not a haiku.
But this is an American sentence, right?
I don't know how that all works, but it's the same as a haiku, but these are not haikus.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I just wanted to like read a couple of them. I left a review on Amazon. If you'd like to leave a review or buy a book or do anything to support it, him, me, go to the link in the show description. Even if you don't want to buy a book, leave a review, because on Amazon, if you get 50 book reviews, it knocks you into the algorithm as a suggested title.
Oh.
And, you know, why not?
And it's a beautiful book. I love the binding, and it's like a hardcover with this like rough edged paper, and it's got it's gorgeous.
Wow. So my family doesn't really talk at all. And so this was really, really beautiful, because not only were we all there together, but I got to learn a lot about my family history that I didn't know before. And so I'm going to try and find this poem. I'm sorry I didn't find it earlier, but let's see. Mary Jane, can you tell me about your favorite poems while I look for this?
Yeah, I've been really into this W.B. Yeats poem of late called The Second Coming, which I think I talked about on here.
Okay, found it.
Oh, God. You gonna read it? You can't crack yourself up that fucking hard, because you know I could talk about poetry for a straight hour.
Oh shit, man! Sorry, thank you for that so much.
Written in 1919, after the end of the First World War, and following the flu pandemic, which his wife had nearly died from. It's a beautiful poem. Okay.
All right. So if you're watching our YouTube, you'll see a picture. This is at the very top of my Uncle Don's staircase when you walk up to the bedroom floor.
Uh-huh.
And it's this picture. That is my great-great-grandfather.
Wow.
On my dad's side, and my great-great-grandmother.
Wow, Mike.
On my dad's side.
How neat.
I've never seen photos of before.
So that's your grandfather's grandfather.
Yeah. So my grandfather, Julius, my grandmother, Ethel.
Yes.
But I don't, and their names are Nahum and Trini.
Wow.
I believe.
Cool.
And they died in 1941.
Mm.
Here's the poem, and then we'll go from there. The temple burns, the Torah fuels the flames. Trapped inside, you struggle to escape the fire. The bima is your funeral pyre. On the wall at the top of the stairs, I see you every day, looking out from a plain black frame, side by side, gazed fixed, blind to a day still years away. A small town near Warsaw, I still hear my mother, your granddaughter, say, I see, in my brother, I see Nahum's nose and eyes, Neil Terry, named for you both, and in my daughter Molly, Trini, too. Besides these photos and your names, the only record that remains of your lives, these likenesses of you still survive, embers from the rubble and the flames.
Wow, Mike.
Do you get it?
They burned in a fire?
During World War. They threw everybody in a temple, lit the Torah on fire, and burned the temple to the ground, and they were burned alive in the temple with all of their, with everyone else in this small Warsaw town.
Unbelievable.
Isn't that fucking crazy?
Mm-hmm.
And then I learned that my grandparents escaped from that same town to come to America,
mm-hmm.
and that's the only reason I'm here.
Mm.
Fucking crazy.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is obviously a very personal book, and that's a very personal poem. There's other poems in here that are not like this, but for me to finally meet and reconnect with my dad's entire side of the family for the first time in so long, and then also learn about my own family history is
powerful.
Powerful. Thank you.
Sorry to put a word in your mouth. I was just sorry.
Well, I was going to make a joke to protect me from my own feelings. So thank you for getting me to go deeper instead of laterally. I appreciate that. So yeah, just really freaking powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's big stuff.
So
it's beautiful. And amazing that he has these photographs of them and that you can look at those faces and see your family.
Yeah, exactly.
That's really incredible.
The rest of them, there's a lot of love poems in here. There's a lot of poems.
I love the little illustrations that I'm seeing as you're flipping through it, too. Like, beautiful little line drawings in there. Are those his?
No, that is actually one of his exes named Ari,
okay,
who flew in to do the illustrations with him for a couple days before parting ways again.
Cool.
Yeah, she's very talented. So there was one other one I was going to read that he really loved. But, you know, whatever. I could go on and on forever, but I think that they're all just fantastic. And that one in particular was important to me, and I just wanted to share.
It's really beautiful, and that's so neat, too, that he could write those and have them for all of you as a family, like for all of you to get a copy and then have that sort of as a binding document.
Yeah.
Like family history and family legacy, obviously it's from his point of view, but then all of you can like add your stories to it. And yeah, the communication and like sharing of stories as a family is so foundational and bonding. And that's, you know, what I think is missing in a lot of cases, right?
It's absolutely missing. Well, mm-hmm. Also, you know, in my grandfather's defense, I don't think he wanted to talk about this stuff ever. And right. I think like anyone who went through World War II on both sides of my family, my mom and dad's side, the men never talked about what they went through.
Right.
They might have yelled at us and hit their kids a bit because they were so angry and didn't know what to do with it. And they didn't get the help they needed.
Yeah.
But they certainly weren't talking about it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, you know. That's, yeah.
Yeah. Not a lot of communication around that. I mean, it's so at that time. So, I mean, still today, people still truly don't know how to talk about grief and trauma because it feels dangerous. Like sometimes, you know, if I feel like I'm in a conversation with someone who doesn't feel like a safe person and they start asking me about any of my experiences that I've had that have been really life shaping around, you know, big events, I can feel like a panic rise in me where I want to run.
Yeah.
Run. And it's only through therapy and having very good friends and like big relationships where I've created a safe space to talk about those things that I've learned to be open about them. But like, I can only imagine the panic and fear of like trying to talk about something that has truly shaped and changed your life in so many ways when you just don't have the tools to do so.
Right.
And you're not in a society that encourages it.
Yeah.
At all.
And possibly the person listening to you is not going to give a response that is good or helpful or what you were looking for.
It's going to make it worse.
It makes it worse.
Yeah, because they're going to have advice or something.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, that's how I grew up.
Right.
Like, if I tell you my problem, your response is, here's how to fix that so I don't have to feel it, you don't have to feel it, and we can move on to happier things.
Right.
And that just doesn't help anybody because I'm not looking for a solve. I'm looking for an ear.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
I have an idea. Here's what you should do.
Yeah. Well, in my family's case, this brings me to my next point that I wanted to bring up. Having not seen these people in a while, mm-hmm. it's very interesting how everyone communicates with each other, especially these three brothers, my dad and his two siblings. The way they communicate is by saying, or actually, I'll be my dad or one of his brothers.
Okay.
Let's play this game. This is a fun game.
Okay.
I think we can have a lot of fun with this.
I hope it's fun. I'm scared. Okay.
So just say something that is 100% true, and it can be simple, it can be easy. The sky is blue, something simple.
Okay. I drive a black Ford Fusion with awesome red leather interior.
Yeah, the problem with that is that red leather interior is going to get hot in the summer, probably going to be tough to sit on. You might need a cover for your, what's it called, the wheel, because it might be too hot to touch. Plus, you know, Ford Fusion, it's half gas, half electric, and you know, gas is getting more and more expensive, so there's going to probably be a bit of a budgetary problem unless you can really keep track of your books with that car. And it also seems really big. I've been in one before, so parallel parking in that is probably really difficult, especially in a big city like Los Angeles.
Because you're a woman. And,
you know, you probably can't parallel park it as easy. Mm. But I great car, love it. But yeah, the problem with it actually is all the following. And that's how they talk. You want to do one?
Exhausting.
It's fun, but it's fun. It's fun. The problem is.
Okay.
Okay. New game.
Okay.
Okay. So you're one of my dad's brothers.
Okay.
Or him.
I'm going to try. Okay. Here we
you
go.
Ready?
Yep. Wait, who am I?
Do you want to be Steve, Neil, or Don?
Well, I know your dad, so I'll be Neil.
Okay.
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 Ready?
Oh, Yeah, my flight from Los Angeles to Boston was so easy. We left on time, landed on time. I slept most of the way.
That sounds great. Did you get points? I can't do
this.
The
problem. Say the problem is.
Oh, the problem with your flight being on time and you sleeping the whole way is that you missed the free meal. And also, probably someone stole all of your stuff when you weren't looking. Have you checked all of your electronics? Did you, and are they password protected? Because hackers now can go into your stuff when you're sleeping and take all of your credit card information. And you should probably go online right now and check all of your credit cards to, because it's Cyber Monday and people are crazy on planes. And also, did you get a COVID test? Is that... Whew, not my default setting. Jesus Christ.
She nailed it.
Wow.
Isn't that fun?
My anxiety is like at an all-time high. It's the little hamster wheel is turning. I hate that feeling.
Oh, woo. Isn't that wild?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the competition and the way to communicate is...
Yeah, who had it worse kind of thing?
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah, my family, my father and my sister were like, had zero impulses towards that. It was always like, you know, how was your day? Great, I saw an osprey and, you know, on my way home, there was a rabbit that crossed my path. Or what? Like, it's just, you know, beautiful observations about sort of the world around us. Mm-hmm. And then my mother was always like, Benazir Bhutto, the Pakistani prime minister, was assassinated and I have to go to bed for 18 days. And we're like, did you know her? Jesus Christ, like there's terrible shit happening all around the world all the time. Did you know her? What's going on? Just lunacy. So
unbelievable.
I get it. The fixating on the sort of like the things that you can like drill down into that are negative. Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder, maybe we'll do a little Instagram story thing sometime after the MJs where it's like, how many of your families communicate with the following word or the following word?
Yeah. Sharing the complaints.
Yeah.
Wild.
The problem is. Such a fun game. That's, and it's so easy to fall into, right?
Yeah.
Because that like cyclical negative nature that then everybody can possibly on with their own thoughts is so contagious that it's just a path of least resistance.
Well, and also speaking of bonding, I did recently read a story about how complaining together is as fundamental as anything for like increasing family structures, like, or friendships, you know, griping together, gossiping together, all that kind of stuff.
Love
like,
shit,
you know,
talking.
Like sharing. Yeah. You and I shit talk all the time. We go on our walk and talks and we're like, can you fucking believe that fucking fuck? No, not about anyone in particular, but just like random, like, I can't remember. What did I have happen recently? I can't even remember, but I broke it down for you over like 20 minutes. It was like an email that I had with a bank. I mean, I talked on here about fighting a parking ticket for fucking 15 minutes.
Yeah, like, exactly.
It's fun. It's fun.
But when everything is like, oh, beautiful day. Well, problem is.
Was it?
I've actually seen the other thing my family is really good at is, instead of saying that's great and then asking to please tell me more, they share something about themselves. So if I were to say, if you say beautiful day.
Yeah, beautiful day today.
Yeah, actually yesterday's was even better when you weren't here. I saw a gorgeous day. Oh, you would have loved that day. Had you gotten here a day earlier, like I suggested,
no.
You would have loved this
no.
day.
When I lived in New York, we had a friend who was a part of the friend circle who we just referred to as... I won't even say the nickname we gave him because everything, you could ask him anything and it was just, it would hit the wall and slide down it and fall flat. He never asked a single fucking question and anything you lobbed at him would immediately be like absorbed into this sort of like negative space and then he'd just be like, and it was just, yeah, it's like, what's that Downer Debbie?
Debbie Downer.
Debbie Downer. Yeah.
Well, last name first, like Canadian way. Right?
Downer Debbie. Yeah. I was, yeah, we were cracking up over Thanksgiving because I kept saying eighth grade and ninth grade.
Yeah.
No, wait. No, I've
grade
Americanized
nine.
Now. Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to say grade 9 and grade 10.
Yeah.
And I guess I've Americanized. They were like, what are you talking about?
And get rid of that army time. You'll be one of us.
Listen, I'm popular because I have military time on my phone. It makes me cool. Bart Radish is a military time. That's me.
this isn't to say that like... my family didn't, we all got along amazing. We all connected, but it was very funny. There was one moment of men talking.
Yes.
Cause my uncle Don,
what were they saying?
Picture, he got a new Mazda Miata 2-seater.
Okay.
And it's gorgeous. And it's a six, you stick shift it and it cuts around.
I love a Miata. Oh, there's your dad.
That's my dad and Don.
Oh, that's Don. Okay.
Looking at the Miata.
Very
he
nice.
He just got it.
Midnight blue.
Gorgeous.
Beautiful. Well, oh,
very well said.
Am I going to be
okay?
Corrected?
Let me be Don.
Okay.
And you be the person I'm showing the Miata to.
Okay.
Yeah. So I just got this Miata. It's a 2-seater.
Gorgeous. Midnight blue, little black leather interior. I love it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you be Don and I'll be my dad.
Okay.
And you say something about your new Miata.
I just got this new Miata.
Oh, it's the same color as my new SUV.
Oh, midnight blue?
Midnight blue. Yeah. It's mine's also, it's an automatic and gets great gas mileage.
I can't do this.
The competition between those brothers is so strong. And I was like, oh, that's where I get it from. Like when we bicker on here and you're like, be more accurate. And I'm like, be more fun and da da da. And we really get into it.
Yeah.
It is all from the Glazer side of the
family.
You
bullying me to be more fun is real effective.
Yeah, right.
As we've learned over the years.
It was so funny. Like, you know, it's the kind of thing where it's like, oh, I wrote it down for stand-up, but it's we were having this conversation because my Uncle Don's really well connected, especially in like law. Mm-hmm. He knows a lot of big, powerful people and has done some great things for the world.
Yeah.
And somebody said something like, I met one of the biggest owners of pepper in North America. And the response would be like, well, it's not salt, though.
Jesus Christ.
Some real alpha stuff. You know what I mean?
Oh, my God. That's so funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel you. I hear you on all of it. It's definitely like the fucking men talking. I did actually pull up a meme that I wanted to share with you because this made me laugh. I saw this post where it's just like about men talking, alpha men, that fucking energy in general. And it says, I'm an alpha male. No, you're not. You're an ass that thinks talking over people makes you important. Do you even know what an alpha does? They feed and protect their pack. Where's your fanny pack full of cheesy crackers, Steve? And it made me laugh fucking so hard because it really is like, especially like when I poke the bro hive on any of the sandwich videos and it's just like these guys coming in with just hot takes and they're like, you know, beta cuck, this, that, and the other thing. And they're just, you know, they're just like these weak ass fucking fragile, angry bros who are not alpha at all. I did find someone when I posted this meme, someone DM me and she was like, do you know what alpha wolves actually do? The alpha wolves will be with an alpha wolf in the middle of a pack, will be in the middle with its mate, its forever mate. They let the older wolves go ahead to set the pace. And then they get let the younger wolves protect the flanks with their like energy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they lead.
From behind.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a real
what an alpha
move.
Alpha does.
Cool.
Alpha does
provides, that. Protects, mm-hmm. leads from behind.
Doesn't come in and tell you what to do.
That's awesome.
By talking.
Yeah. Quick disclaimer, the meme says Steve. That is my dad's name, as I've established. But
not
this is
directed,
not about Steve.
Not directed at Steve Glazer.
I had a lovely time with my family.
This is the best.
They're great. They're great, great people, all of them.
Yeah.
It was just very funny to see the dynamics from childhood come bubbling up again.
Always.
You know?
A bubbling. Yeah.
Like a pot pie.
Fantastic.
the problem with fantastic is it's not terrific.
Yeah. Nor is it awesome or incredible. They all have their place in the world.
Fucking great.
Fantastic. I think that's it for this week, right? We got to get ready because we have to get on a plane and go to Vegas immediately.
Yeah, it's true. We do.
You want to do buds of the week?
Let's do buds of the week.
Okay.
Can I go first?
I would love you to go first.
As the alpha male of this pod? My bud of the week this week is actually not on the internet because he's way too cool for any kind of social media. It's my brother, Matt Glazer. We had an awesome time in Boston together. And then he had an awesome time with Patrick back home. And Patrick's whole family came to visit in St. Louis. Double awesome. And if you're watching our YouTube, you can see he has these Thanksgiving sneakers and no one that I saw in the family commented on them. And I had to take a picture and shout them out because they did not get the credit they deserve.
Wow. These are sensational fucking sneakers. And just to be clear, Patrick is Matthew's husband.
Correct.
Yes. Sensational. Did Patrick also have these sneakers?
No, Patrick did not. Matthew was the only one with this kind of like pizzazz.
I mean, I don't even, these are Brooks?
Brooks, which I don't know the shoe company, but
really?
Man, oh man. Yeah, I don't know Brooks.
Huh.
Should I?
I feel like they're super famous. Yeah,
really?
They're pretty big.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I feel like I had Brooks at one point. Not that that's a flex or anything. I didn't have these Thanksgiving sneakers.
Mm-mm.
What are we looking at, man? Mike?
I mean, they just have like pie.
Mike's mad that I said Brooks is a thing.
Yeah.
So mad right now.
My arms crossed.
So mad.
My arms
got all
naturally
quiet
crossed.
And you crossed your arms. Jesus. Tell us about these sneakers. It's fucking wild.
There's a turkey on the toe, knives, forks, rosemary, melting butter, oven mitts. Like, they're just a heck of a Thanksgiving sneaker. And
gorgeous orange.
Yeah. I just wish that they had been such a centerpiece. And so I needed to bring them up and say that Mac Glazer is my butt of the week for his absolutely fantastic taste in Thanksgiving attire.
Thanksgiving sneakers. I didn't even know that was a thing. They're gorgeous. The laces also, like, they look like there's some sort of thing happening with the tongue that's like a textured kind of shag carpet there.
Yeah. They're Ooh, fancy.
Hot.
Yeah. So that's my butt of the week. And we don't have to tag him because he's not online anymore.
Not on social media. Really? Exactly. Did he leave socials?
Well, he has it, but he has no followers, no posts, no nothing. He just uses it so that we can like DM fun videos of platypuses playing and things like that.
Amazing.
Yeah.
That's what it should be for, really. That's Kinda. All of us, all any of us should care about.
Yeah. For DMs of videos that you might find entertaining.
Here is a cat. Awesome butt of the week.
Thanks.
Well, my butt of the week is my friend Sara McCooe at Love Light Ascension on Instagram. Sara and I met a long ass time ago when we used to both work the Cannabis Cup events at High Times, and she married John. They're an incredible couple. John was in sales. He works with Cannabiotics now, and they have a beautiful little baby. And Sara just recently sent me a pair of gorgeous, glittery, bejeweled pot leaf earrings with this sweet card. And it was just so touching because we haven't seen each other since I moved to LA, except for one like passing at a party. And it was just so nice to be thought of and have a gift mailed to me from someone who I've known and loved for a long time, but just hadn't heard of in forever. And she was like, hey, you know, wear these when you're making some of your sandwiches. And it was just great. So Sara, thank you so much. Look how beautiful she is. She's just the most Love Late Ascension is her handle, and it says a lot about her.
Oh, perfect handle.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what, she's heard of Brooks too? Is that part of
Yes, she's also heard of Brooks, and she's not mad about it. A spicy one.
Fantastic. This is great. I'm so glad that you had a really great Thanksgiving.
Me too. Happy holidays, Mike. We're in it now.
We are in it. And Thanksgiving was so, so awesome. Shout out to my whole family for making it work, coming in from all over the country to hang. Mm-hmm. And
shout out to the Hansons and the Natalie and everyone who made my Thanksgiving happen. It was truly beautiful.
Oh, let's go. What? But let's go on. Shout out. Wait. If my cousins mm-hmm. have kids,
yes.
What am I to them?
Second cousin?
Mm-hmm.
Or first cousin once removed. I can't remember how it works.
My cousin has like kids.
Your cousin's children, I believe, are second cousins.
Okay. Whatever. They're all...
your cousins.
They're awesome.
You can marry them.
Flag football. Oh. They're awesome at flag football. Mm-hmm. And one of them, Ethan, won the Super Bowl of flag football.
Wow.
And the other one, another one, Ryan, he was on ESPN making the game-winning catch to win the championship for his team. Like, these are just like dope, athletic, fun, cool kids. And it feels good to have champions in the family. So I want to shout out my...
More champions
in the family. So I just want to shout out my cousin's kids who may or may not be my first or second cousin.
Great. follow us at Weed and Grub on Instagram. Email us wg@weedandgrub.com. Pictures, suggestions, things you want to hear us talk about.
I want to hear
about.
You talk about your family dynamics.
Yeah, let's hear it. Send over pictures of your Thanksgiving successes and fails and holiday recipes and anything. And we're probably going to have to write a gift guide at some point if you have suggestions of things you want us to include in our holiday gift guide, that good stuff.
And we got a DM from someone with a really good suggestion for a candy corn recipe for me. So I still got to make that candy corn dish for us. So.
Well, it's not going bad. So you have years. thanks so much for hanging out with us. As always, it's a great time, and I guess we'll see you next week.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.